Hello, everybody. In today's discussion, we have with us Payal Kapoor. She's a motivational speaker and a disability inclusion evangelist. Welcome, Payal.
Thanks so much, Smita. Thank you for having me here.
How did this journey begin from being a little Payal to a TEDx speaker? How did it all, and also starting your own little venture that we were speaking about?
Life gives you opportunities, I think. You know, it's the lemon and lemonade story mostly. I think for me, mainly, my life is truly what happened when I was very busy making other plans. So, 22, hotel management graduate, and 2 years into the industry, looking at a fabulous life ahead, both personally and professionally. One day, life decides that it needs to mix it all up and add some excitement. So there I go, suddenly falling sick. And, you know, one wouldn't even think that it would eventually become into something that is so big. So within a space of about, I think, 10 days from being totally healthy, you know, seeing person, I became a totally blind person who saw her face one morning in the mirror and didn't the next. So in about a week's time, the deterioration was complete. Ahead, further, and there was more damage waiting for me. I lost my sense of taste and smell completely. I lost my hearing after a certain point in time. So December of 1992, or January actually, I was totally deafblind. So that was a metamorphosis completely and all of that. But like I said, things happen. I was very fortunate to have had a very, very strong support system around me. My family, my friends, many times that I wanted to give up, they simply wouldn't allow me. So they kept egging me on, kept pushing me on. And I think somewhere that little dying ember of a spirit that was within me sort of was getting fanned very slowly. And I think at some point, I just got fed up of being blind and got fed up of being dependent and just got tired of everything. And decided to put myself into active rehabilitation, which I had resisted for 6 years, in complete denial and still hoping that I would see again. So my hearing in the meantime, fortunately, had come back, and 1 year started working. So that was good enough for me to be able to take life ahead. And that's exactly what I did. So I went ahead, got rehabilitated, fortunately got employed by the same organization where I was rehabilitated. You know, teaching, becoming a resource person for everything that I had fought against, learning, wanting to learn Braille, which was really hard, having to pick up the cane, white cane for mobility, that was so against my vanity. And, you know, having to do so many things differently. I ended up becoming a teacher, a mentor to many other blind people through this organization. And later, it just kind of continued. So that's it. I mean, then I went back into the hotel industry. So my confidence kept growing after that with every hit, everything that I saw. And life kept coming at me. I was supposed to get married, then I fell sick, then that entire relationship fell apart. And I mean, it kept coming at me. But then I think something in me had in the meantime risen and I kept pushing back. So learned new technologies, started learning things, started working on the regular computer. I had learned Braille so far. So I was using a Braille input, what's it called, a notepad kind of a thing. But I, you know, moved on to the regular computers and things like that. And one by one, things started happening. 12 years back in the hotel industry, doing a job that I didn't particularly enjoy, but I had to because I didn't have a choice since my career had been taken away from me by my disability. And kept looking for newer options, kept reinventing myself. That took me to various places, independent, grew up, got married, marriage broke, I still went on, kept on at it. And I think today I find myself at a place which is very, very wonderful, because through all the reinventions, I had accepted my disability very, very long ago. But today I'm very proud as a blind woman, as somebody who's there, part of a beautiful, vibrant community of people with disabilities, and in a position to give back to them through, you know, creating sensitization in the community through my own projects with helping them learn skills, life skills and things like that. So yes, TEDx also happened in the middle there. So that's pretty much it in sort of a nutshell, if I may.
it was like a movie for me, Payal, what you just relayed. But I have a question. For a 22-year-old, okay, to get a setback of the kind that you went through, what was your emotional condition? I'm sure it was bad, but then how did you gather yourself to do what you're doing today?
I'm basically an emotional person myself. I mean, I'm more, I think, more from my heart than my head often, although my final decisions are not based on that. But my instinctual reaction is emotional. So, but I think somewhere within me, there was this person that was probably latent all this time. And, in the years of being ill and everybody who supported me and things like that. But the fact that I was finally able to take the decision to move ahead after the complete devastation. I mean, I was a basket case. I was just a complete vegetable and I was deemed, doomed rather, I would say. The doctors had said that she's never going to walk again and she's going to vegetate and this is what it's going to be and all that kind of, doomsday predictions they had for me. But my family was there, so they were always supporting me. And so within me, I think I just, like I said, I got fed up of being dependent. And in every adversity, I think what worked for me is somewhere in my head, I had decided that things will go wrong and that in every adversity that was there, there was an opportunity for me. I saw those opportunities. Something opened up in my mind and I saw those opportunities. And then everything that came, I knew, I kept telling myself, okay, this too shall pass. Today is a bad day. I know that this day is only 24 hours. Tomorrow is going to look better. And I just kept pushing myself on and on, on and on through this entire craziness that was my life. And for that matter, even during my marriage, which was not good. I had a hard 8 years. And even there, today, when I look at it, despite all the devastation and the destruction that happened to my sense of self, I saw that if I hadn't been there, I wouldn't have been the independent woman I am today. Because I took the bull by the horns and just went for it, ran a house, worked, managed things around the house, managed emotional craziness and everything. So I think, yes, that's what it was, basically. Apart from the entire supportive environment, I think I had simply decided that this was it. Life was not going to take a hit at me all the time and just, go away. So that's, I think, how it worked.
How do we create a supportive infrastructure to enable careers and professional growth of persons with disability? Is there any mantra for it, or is there any feedback from you for the policymakers?
In life, you're saying, or are you talking professionally?
Professionally, like, see, ours is such a large country, it's a huge demographic, but there are percentage of people who have various kinds of disabilities, right? They could be small number, but they are important numbers. How do we ensure that we create a supportive infrastructure for them so that, they are not left behind in their professional growth? Yesterday, I was speaking to somebody who was struck with polio, and she is diversity and inclusion head in one of the IT companies. And she was sharing some of her woes, right? That what she went through. Simple things like people don't even ask, for example, it was a factory setup. They didn't even ask her whether she'll be comfortable, but they outright rejected her, saying, okay, she might not be able to do that. When I was discussing this with her, I was like, yeah, even it's a simple question, whether you'll be able to manage or not manage. We do not know their strength. So something that I learned. So how do we create a supportive infrastructure to enable careers?
First thing that I think is you have to open your mind to the fact that there are people different from you. At the core, that is where it begins. It is an attitude. It is mindset of acceptance. And acceptance not as somebody who's disabled. Acceptance as a fact that this is a person first, disability later. And this is a person who has skills that are slightly different from yours only because he has had to adapt to those. For instance, let me give you an example. You and I are sitting on this conversation. Nobody has an idea that you don't know how I've set myself up here and done everything. I've done everything on my own. So I've used adaptive technology, whatever my capabilities are as a blind person, as a partially hearing impaired person, to come to this meeting today, to have this conversation with you today. What is the difference? There is no difference because there is no barrier. What is the barrier? Barrier is the infrastructure, whether it is physical, whether it is emotional, whether it is mental. That is the only barrier. I'm using the same technology you are. I'm adapting to it. It's just that that's just as simple as it is. I have to come to some place. I will find my way how to come to you. I'll take a cab just like you do. I'm using my mobile phone just like you are, which is slightly different. And I'm coming to you. I have skills. I have education just like anybody else does. So for a person to begin to recognize the fact that a person with disability is a person first and a disability later is extremely important. And it has to be in the core component of and the core values of an organization of a person to realize this, to be able to create an infrastructure differently. I mean, that's your cornerstone that everything's going to be built on, because after this, it becomes easy. Once you've opened your mind to saying, okay, this is a person and I'm going to either learn how to deal with this person or what I can do for this person in terms of a career or, you know, in terms of upskilling or teaching them new skills or something like that. You've also opened your mind to the fact that there's nothing different about this person. The only thing they're doing different is living their lives in a slightly different manner from you. So that, I think, is where you need to absolutely begin. Everything else comes on top, whether it is physical infrastructure, as in building an office that is accessible for a wheelchair user, using technology or making, you know, the technology or spaces that you have more accessible for people with blindness and, you know, skilling your staff with maybe sign language to help a person with hearing and speech impairment or something else for a person with an intellectual disability. So I think that's where it all begins.
That leads me to another question. What you were discussing is that we see that you have adapted to technology like fish to the water. Can you tell us about how did you go about doing that?
Technology, I think, is the biggest boon to people with disabilities. Is the biggest, it makes the biggest difference for people with, you know, vision impairment, primarily because the element of seeing is taken away from us. So the adaptation that is required in terms of technology is way higher for us on a day-to-day basis than it is for people with other disabilities. Having said that, people with hearing and speech impairment also need to use it. People with locomotor disabilities also use a lot of technology now to, use on their wheelchairs, etc., various things. But for us, every step of the way, it's a little bit of an issue. I've basically started with technology very early and then have just kept moving on with times. We've had lots of help. So that's what I would say for people. For me, it's a journey. Every day I have something new. You have a new update coming in, then, you know, I want to tell them that, no, I don't want to do this. But you don't have a choice, because if you don't do it, eventually it's just going to land up on your phone or land up on your laptop, and then you're going to have to do it. And then I keep my fingers crossed and, you know, pace around the room like, you know, probably an expectant father would, and wondering, oh God, now this is going to go up and now what's going to happen to my system. But all in all, I think it works just fine. And this is where I think most people with blindness and vision impairment lose out on their opportunities with employment to a great deal, because that is where the organizations need to make place for them. You know, they have to make changes. They have to create accessibility with their tools or with their softwares that they use and things like that. It's not impossible. It's just something that needs to be done. I mean, after all, we are signatories. India is a signatory of the United Nations Convention for Rights of Persons with Disability, in which the component of accessibility, if you read the document, is a very small paragraph. But it's tightly knit and says everything that it has to. You can't use the excuse saying that, you know, I don't have something for use because I don't have accessibility for the tool that I need you to use. It's my right as a person with blindness, and it's something that you need to do as an employer. In fact, recently I was reading a case where a person with blindness was asked to quit his job because the tool that the company was using was not accessible to him. It doesn't work like that.
So I would want to share a personal story, Payal. Yes. Before, very young, younger days in IT company, and we designed a code of business conduct program. And there were two people who were visually impaired, who, and I was an HR person. I had designed this policy. So they came across to me and they said, okay, the policy is there and you have designed it, but it is not helping our cause because the way it was laid out, it was not friendly for them to be able to read it. That was an aha moment for me that, you know, we are not being sensitive. I was exposed to it for the first time, right? So I took a step back and I said, you know, there is something that we are not doing it correctly. It's not because I don't want to do it. It's because I'm unaware of it. Right? I don't know what are the challenges people go through. It happened.
It's bound to happen with most people. It happens a lot because they just simply don't know. And what you don't know, but that's what I said. You have to open your mind to possibilities. That's where it begins. Your desire to do something.
So, Payal, do you think it is a good idea as a country, as humankind, that we should start speaking about, you know, different kinds of people that we will meet in our life? And what are the do's and don'ts of dealing with them? How you should be sensitive? Because in our school or in our college, nowhere such lessons are taught to us. Even in corporate, till really long time, if you don't have to deal with them, you don't need to learn. But that's, I think, a wrong thought process.
So that's something that we are doing now. It's becoming more and more prominent. It's becoming, actually, this new act that came in, the new law, the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act of 2016, it's a paradigm shift in a manner of speaking. So there have been a lot of very, very clear instructions given in that, and mandates and, you know, various things. So that's a good place for someone to start. But having said that, see, it's very simple for somebody to say that I want to do this. And but like you said, you don't know how. So there are many agencies, there are many organizations that are specializing in, you know, creating awareness and sensitization through workshops, through training programs and things like that. There are individuals like me who go out there, put ourselves out there and, you know, interact with the community, you interact with people, with organizations and tell them and, you know, talk to them and talk to them about our skills and tell them what we're capable of doing. And I think what is extremely important again here in an organization that is desirous of having people with disabilities is to have a disability services department. It could be two individuals, but have somebody who is going to be sensitive, who has information, who has knowledge of what it's going to entail for you to hire, for you to train, for you to sensitize and all of that thing. So that could be a one point. That is again, one thing that the law says that it's a good thing to have. Most places don't have this. So can I give you an example? What happens usually is that there are many, many people out there today in this world who are so fabulously capable and so high up there in organizations, you know, who are disabled. They're at the senior manager, what's it called, VPs and senior VPs and all sorts of very, very high posts they hold. But what happens is because they're looking at, they're trying to do what they can do, but you're bound by policies and et cetera, et cetera. So then sitting at that place, somebody's going to say that, okay, I want to hire so many people with disabilities. And okay, or what do you know about it? You don't know anything about it. So you're going to just go ahead and hire somebody. That somebody is going to come into your organization and you're going to assign him a team. You're going to assign him to somebody who's going to look at him and say, but I don't want him. He's going to affect my numbers. He's going to impact my performance reports without even giving a person a chance. So that's where exactly like you said, there is the requirement of, you know, sensitization. So organizations need to open up. You know, we've moved way ahead of CSR. We are no longer sitting in a CSR space. Disability is no longer a CSR space. So give them jobs. Give them, you know, keep them at par with everyone. Understand what they're doing. That's where it all begins from. So the sensitization is what is most important. Reach out to us. Reach out to people. There are organizations who need to do this. So the dialogue is extremely important. The conversation is extremely important. That's where the change will start. Otherwise, it's not about to happen.
And quite intriguing, you know, the act that came up, persons with disabilities, really needs to get attention.
Absolutely. That's the pillar. That's the pillar. And believe me, it is very easy. It is so simple to understand. And it is so absolutely explicit about what is required of corporates, what is required of a government, what kind of facilities you need to provide. Everything is very clearly laid out. And it was a huge victory from the Archaic Act of 1995 to 2016. Can you imagine? It took us that long to even change our way of thinking in a population that has how many percent of our population? I think 1.38% that are disabled. It took us...
Big number.
Yeah, it took us that long to be even able to change the law, you know, and do things. And we went from 7 disabilities. Imagine 7 disabilities that were notified. We went from 7 to 21 disabilities now. It's still not easy. See, the law is very nice. It's very nice to say there's a law and you can be tried, you know, in the court of law for non-compliance and all that. But we know the reality on the ground, what it is. So it's a personal, I think it starts with character of an organization and the character of what you want to build that matters.
While taking this discussion forward, were you ever discriminated because of your condition or being a woman? So did you face any discrimination? It is a double thing, right? And being a woman, being disabled, did you face discrimination?
It's a huge, in India, the intersectionality is a very scary one. To be standing at the intersectionality of woman and disability, it's not easy. I mean, in the sense that in the community, there is no real, you know, gender inequality, so to speak, you know, the workspace and things. It's not as if they're going to hire, you know, a disabled man over a disabled woman for a particular reason. I haven't really actively seen anything like that, but I have two examples in my head that come from me as a woman who's been disabled. I'm the marginalized community to start with in our country. I was born a girl child, so that itself, not the family, but everywhere else outside. So I have two examples that I'd like to cite to you. One personally at a personal level and at a professional level. Personally, through my marriage, I was, you know, doing everything that needed to be done as the woman of the house and as a contributing member in terms of holding a job and everything. So at that point in time, it was like I didn't need to be helped because I was being given independence. My husband at that time didn't think it was necessary to give me a hand because I was an independent woman and I had chosen to be independent and things like that. So it was okay for me to be doing everything. And he was also apparently giving me the space because he thought I was capable of doing everything despite being disabled. It was a dichotomy completely because what he was doing was his expectations from me as the woman of the house and as a disabled woman was completely unreal to a great extent because while I was independent and I could do everything, I had needs as a disabled person, more as a disabled woman, both put together. And as a woman, they think, you know, that when women's liberation is something that they take very far, it's a very, very feminism and things like that are very, very misconstrued kind of statements to basically suit somebody's needs, as far as I've seen. So that's what used to happen. I used to end up doing everything because I wanted to be an independent woman. And he was being nice to me because I was disabled. And he was only showing the world that, look, I'm giving her so much space to be a disabled woman and be independent. It broke my back. That was really tough. So that was one aspect where I thought that there was complete craziness in this entire, you know, misconception of what he construed as me being a disabled woman, an independent disabled woman. And professionally, in the organization where I worked for 12 years, People knew me well. I think I created the culture of disability around there for them to be sensitive, for them to be able to see me and things like that. But I was still invisible in a lot of ways, in the meetings and things like that when I used to sit because I had been hired, I don't think out of the kindness of a person's heart, but I was hired because they saw something and I was hired for 3 months and I went on to be there for 12 years. They must have seen something there. But again, I was mostly invisible. And I have one very, very unfortunate incident I'd like to share, which I share in most of my conversations because it's so important. I was at in a quarterly sales meeting, you know, in the company, and it was in the city where I am at, where I originate from. So that hotel was hosting, we were hosting this particular event. And it had sales managers, sales heads, national sales head, CEO, so on and so forth, all the top brass and my colleagues and senior colleagues, everybody present. I was the only woman and I was the only disabled woman. Sitting in, having a conversation, presentations going on, so on and so forth. And I'm sitting there. Suddenly they break for coffee. And they say, okay, we'll be back in 10 minutes. So I gathered up my papers and, I mean, whatever I had with me and put them all into a file and everything, ready to get up to go for coffee. And I was talking to my neighbor, whoever was sitting next to me. I had been having a discussion with him. The next thing I knew, by the time I even had time to stand up, the hall had emptied. And I was left talking to air. There was not a single soul left in the hall who thought it necessary to take me to have my coffee. A bunch of men. I haven't been more humiliated in my life. I cannot begin to tell you what I even today feel about it, really.
Is there any, you know, infrastructure for mental health support for specially abled folks? Is there an infrastructure for that?
No. Officially, we don't have any mental health support. No. It's just what we do. Yes, there are organizations that, you know, a lot of non-governmental kind of NGO kind of spaces that offer mental health, you know, support and things like that. But if there's somebody that we need to just simply reach out to, there isn't any. We just, within our own networks, we support each other, we prop each other up and things like that. And we help each other out of whatever crunches we think we are in. But if it is serious and we think, then we have to go out and look for help. There's, I don't know of anybody who's, I've heard of organizations, but nothing that is like connected officially. That's the only word I can use really. No.
Any quick tips for women who are listening to this conversation?
Don't allow anybody to tell you you're not strong. Don't allow anybody to take your agency from you. And you have the strength. Every woman has an innate strength within herself that she's sometimes not aware of only because the environment around her has not been conducive. So don't let anyone tell you otherwise. You are stronger than you think you are. But at the same time, don't let someone use the fact that, oh, you're so strong and you can do everything on your own and dump everything on yourself. No, be smart. Be, you know, aware of what is coming at you. Take care of yourself, definitely. Put yourself before anybody else. That doesn't mean that you need to be selfish. But I think we sort of just lose ourselves and our identities in this entire huge thing that is family and work and all of that. I think that's something that we need to take care of, definitely.
Any quick tips for the organization to create a conducive environment for women? For people with
women as such, or disabilities, women with disabilities, or just women.
So women, set of women, okay, and people with disabilities.
Okay. Today, women are recognized a lot. In fact, people with disabilities lose out to the women percentage in the diversity, quotient right now. Because the minute you say diversity, the first thing that comes up is women. That's the largest percentage, I think, in the diversity quotient everywhere. But I would think organizations definitely need to take more care of their women in terms of, I see that a lot of organizations are rising to the occasion with, you know, helping them upskill, especially women who come back after maternity breaks and things like that, to take them back in, to help them support the children. It's extremely important. You take care of your women and, they'll definitely give you their absolute best, but you have to take care of their mental health as well. And yes, what you guys are doing, harassment, please. Just you have to be more sensitive and you have to take care. That holds good also for people with disabilities as well. You have to recognize them as a workforce, as a producing workforce, as a, you know, progressive workforce. Don't have them because you have to mandate them. I mean, it's a mandate and you need 3% because tomorrow there's an inspector who's going to come and look at it and you're going to say, okay, on my register, I have so many. It's pointless. Pick them for the skills they have or train them. Give them the skills, bring them at par, and put them in the regular rigmarole of things, you know, and give them promotions, give them demotions. Recognize them as individuals and not as a disability.
Thank you so much, Payal. Thank you for coming on to this summit and giving us some important tips, right? Taking us through your journey, because, you know, sometimes when we are sitting on the other side, we really don't know what people on the other side are facing. So thank you very much for being open and candid and taking us through this journey, giving us some amazing tips for women, for people with special needs. Really, really honored to have you on our show.
Thank you so much, Smita. Thank you for having me here and giving me an opportunity to share all of this because it's just simply important. And I just had a wonderful time having this conversation. What's most important is the fact that you've seen the need for a conversation. That is where it all begins. Thanks again.